If you want to become a full stack developer, follow this roadmap. A full stack developer is someone who is proficient in both front end and back end technologies. This means you can dabble in all areas of the application. Now, if you look online, you'll see gigantic charts of things you should and should not do, and it's beyond overwhelming. Either that, or it'll give you a front end or back end developer roadmap just combined into this gigantic mega chart. I do have videos on this, by the way. If you're starting from absolute scratch and have the end goal to become a full stack developer, this is for you. Instead of listing off 10,000 different technologies, I'm going to give a streamlined version of things you should learn. Take into consideration that you should learn each individually pretty thoroughly and not just try to rush over the whole entire thing. If you want this fancy infographic I made, you can download it through my new newsletter that I have started called The Better Dev. Link below. Let's go. HTML and CSS. HTML and CSS is where you should start your journey first. But why? HTML and CSS is a great way to start your journey because it gives the true fundamentals of a developer workflow and lets you understand how a computer renders things on the screen. In this case, it's your web browser rendering the stuff on your screen. If you're more interested in other technologies like mobile app development, I would still recommend learning this as a prerequisite. How a document is rendered and displayed is important because eventually you'll need to know how it's manipulated by your backend. Keep it PG in the comments, folks. Keep it PG. CSS is used on the web, but the Flexbox positioning system is also used in mobile development as well. So if you're interested in going in that route sometime in the future, you should 100% learn it. A big part of my confusion when I first started learning code was how the screen rendered the data and processed that data. So HTML and CSS is a great place to start. Internet.
You kids and your internet. Back in my day,
we had websites that refreshed on every action you did. The internet is self-explanatory. It's how I'm talking to you right now. And it's also how applications talk to each other as well. The most important part is to understand how internet-related technologies work with your applications, specifically HTTP, DNS, domain names and how they see your app, hosting. More on that later though. How browsers read data. For example, when you go to lewismenelaws.com, your browser connects to a server using HTTP. The server then returns an HTML and CSS and JavaScript document to your browser that then renders for you to see. That was a little tidbit for you. I like you guys, but you're gonna have to continuously learn the internet. Don't skip it over. There's a mandatory 100 question exam at the end of this video that will lock your computer if you don't do it. So study right now. JavaScript. JavaScript is the cool kid on the block. JavaScript's like the new kid on the block who has a trampoline in his backyard, and then suddenly no one wants to hang out with you because you accidentally wet yourself in the second grade, which was like 5 years ago, okay? Sorry. JavaScript. JavaScript is a programming language that is used in all modern browsers and PDF files, which is kind of sus. This is where you'll first be introduced to programming and the capabilities that you can do with a general purpose programming language. JavaScript is one of the most popular programming languages, probably because most people use it to interact with web pages. With JavaScript, you can do advanced computational tasks, make HTTP requests to servers to then render on screen, manipulate HTML and CSS elements. So like if you press a button, turn the background green or something, and many, many more. I think JavaScript is one of the best programming languages to learn as a beginner because of its simplicity and its gigantic ecosystem. At this stage, I would investigate how to make a game of some sort on the browser with HTML and CSS and JavaScript. This way you can truly understand all of the technologies from an individual perspective. Now, if you want to stick with this roadmap, be careful because you can go down a huge rabbit hole here. We'll talk about TypeScript, which you should learn at a later stage, and we can learn about frameworks, libraries, whatever. Just stick with vanilla JavaScript and avoid all the buzzwords and that forum talks, whatever. Linux and servers. You know that one Linux user at a party that's like, they don't know that I primarily use Linux as my daily driver operating system. Well, it turns out that they're kind of right about things. If you want to become a full stack developer, you will have to understand the server because that's how people are going to be receiving information for their applications. When we're talking about the backend, the first layer that you connect to is the server. On those servers, you have an operating system. And Linux consists of most of these servers. Like, hold on. Let me go look this up. 96.3% of the world's 1 million servers run on Linux. Okay, That's a lot of servers. Servers work similarly to how your current computer works, but is often set up in a way to be up all the time. Learning things like the terminal, command line, threads and concurrency, networking, input and output management, and more will help you understand how a server processes your application. This step is extremely necessary and is often a step that is skipped because it's not as exciting as creating super epic applications. And just to let you know, system administrators make a pretty good salary and look badass on a resume. Up to you though. Learn a general purpose programming language. Hey, while we're on servers, you did learn that at this point, right? You didn't skip it? It's time to learn a general purpose programming language. Now, let's see here. You got Rust, PHP, Go, Java, C#, Python, Ruby, Scala, Elixir, LuScript. All of these are great options, but what if I told you that you already learned a general purpose programming language? If you follow this video, JavaScript. JavaScript can be run outside of the browser using the runtime environment known as Node.js. Of course, learning JavaScript is absolutely necessary when you're working on the front end, which is why if you're a beginner, I would say to keep up with Node.js on the back end to move through things faster. You'll see lots of debates online telling you which programming language is the best, and Node.js does have its fair criticisms. But for the type of applications you'll want to deploy, Node.js does an amazing job of making the development experience very easy. What translates really well for JavaScript is the gigantic ecosystem that you're probably already used to. So you can use different frameworks, more on this later, and libraries to build out your application at a much faster pace. So if you want to be an epic programmer, just learn some JavaScript with Node. If you have in mind something you already want to learn, then go for it. But these programming language choices are really not needed this early into your career. Discord switched databases and eventually languages based on their needs after billions of messages. You can check out my video on that right here. Databases and SQL. All right, you got data. How do you store that thing? Databases, of course. But when you look up databases, you get a scary amount of databases to choose from. You may remember this from my backend developer roadmap video, where baby Lewis tells you about the two types of databases to choose from. So I'll just repeat it here. You have NoSQL databases and you have SQL databases. Both have their pros and cons. SQL databases have relationships between data while NoSQL aren't. SQL databases are table-based while NoSQL databases are document-based. SQL databases are best for multi-row transactions while NoSQL is better for unstructured data. Okay, I'm gonna do a scary teacher thing where I'm just gonna pull the rug from underneath you and tell you, you have to choose this one on your own. I would learn both Postgres, which is a SQL relational database, and MongoDB, which is a NoSQL database. The reason I say this is because whatever application you end up building, one of these databases will benefit from that type of application. Once you learn each, you'll have a general understanding of what other databases can work within your programming project. When you learn SQL, you're likely to understand almost how all the SQL databases work. NoSQL can be different, but you should be good. Okay, that gave me anxiety. Let's move on. APIs and libraries. APIs, or application programming interfaces. See, I know what I'm talking about. Is a way for two or more computer programs to communicate with each other. Okay, I admit, I just took the Wikipedia definition here. Let's do a little history lesson real quick from the rest of our video here. If you use JavaScript to submit a form and wanted some data back, currently we have it set that our front-end application goes to the server, runs the code, gets data from the database, but no way to communicate back to our front-end app. It's like seeing someone talk on Zoom, but they're muted the entire time. In this instance, APIs refer to multiple things, such as serializing your data, which is just a fancy word for turning your text data into a format readable for your browser, sending data through HTTP and hopefully an S at the end of it, and optionally, authentication. So how exactly do we do this? Well, there's lots of packages and libraries that help you do this exact thing. Brief pause as I mentioned my philosophy around how to learn things. We're getting into the APIs and libraries so late into this video because I truly believe that if you're wanting to learn something, you first need to understand the issue that each area is solving. For most of the other areas that I have mentioned, getting hands-on at the low level really helps you understand. However, this far into your journey, we can just trust that a simple explanation is good enough for us to move forward. Do you want to spend time learning how to manipulate data, or would you just like to run this simple function and live life? Yeah, That's what I thought. A lot of the time when you learn a framework or library, you'll often have a lot of features affiliated with one. For example, if you learn JavaScript, you'll for sure know about Express.js and how it can help you build routes in your websites or help you return data to your front end. Or you might know about Prisma, that is an ORM, which stands for Object Relational Mapping. I know, developers love their acronyms, which takes an easy to read syntax and converts it to SQL for you. You can get carried away really, really easily. But the important part is to understand what each package does specifically. These tools are here to help you, not to replace you. Security. There are some real bad apples out there, so it's best for you to understand how to properly secure your applications. Now, at this point in your journey, you have probably used hundreds of packages that rely on hundreds of packages that rely on hundreds of packages. You get it. Despite using other people's code, it's really important to constantly make sure that you're updating your dependencies if a known vulnerability is found. First, you want to learn about concepts in cybersecurity. Things like HTTPS, cores, SSL, and more are just the start where it comes to security on the browser and server. Damn, there is a lot of acronyms. You can also learn lots from the Open Web Application Security Project that shows many tools and ways that apps can be vulnerable. Most importantly, security just isn't a step. Security should be in every single aspect that you do of your programming journey. Front-end library and build tools. Now, at this stage, you're already really equipped to make some incredible web applications. But I will say this step is a heavy recommendation. Choosing a front-end UI library will really help speed up your productivity. My personal choice is React for its gigantic ecosystem and popularity. When building a user interface and user experiences, it's best to find a system that will not make you constantly code things from scratch. And with React's ecosystem and component-based system, it just makes it easy to blaze through absolutely everything. You can also start dabbling into things like Next.js, which is React but server-side rendered, so you can pick up a better Google search and optimize performance to use a server's computing power. Of course, both are optional, but the option is 100% there for you at this rate. Vue, Angular, Svelte are also great options, but just choose one and stick with one. At this rate, you basically have all of the knowledge you need to create an incredible experience online. You'll find that depending on where you're niching yourself, there's even more libraries that you can use and learn throughout your journey. Again, it's all relative to what your needs are. So I'm going to briefly discuss some things that you should learn after you're done your core journey. CSS frameworks and compilers. One thing I highly recommend is CSS frameworks and CSS preprocessors. I absolutely hate writing CSS code, and SAS makes it a lot of fun. Or you could use something like Tailwind CSS, where you can write a configuration file and use a bunch of utility classes to make things easier and faster. Some people swear by these, and I'm one of those people. TypeScript. JavaScript is pretty awesome. But you know what's not awesome? Bugs in your JavaScript code. This is why I love TypeScript. You heard my philosophy before, so I won't go on and on about it, but I think TypeScript is one of those things that people should 100% learn after they learn JavaScript. TypeScript adds types into your JavaScript so that when you're writing your code, you can easily catch bugs before they deploy. It sounds complicated, but it's just so darn amazing. Docker. You know the classic predicament. It works on my machine, it just doesn't work on yours. Docker allows you to take all of the little pieces of your application and containerize everything so that it runs similar on all machines. It is somewhat similar to a virtual machine, but doesn't require an operating system for each individual container or application you're trying to run in your stack. The cloud. The cloud is a term you see everywhere, but is mysterious in ways. The cloud just means that you're renting someone else's servers that are much better than yours. However, it's done on the micro level, so most times you pay by the hour instead of a monthly plan. The cloud probably needs its own dedicated video, but you can just learn about that later. DevOps. DevOps is something you'll for sure use in the future because automating the tasks you want to do is key to your productivity. Learning a CI/CD tool or infrastructure as code or monitoring your applications are all key to your success, as a less busy developer. There is so much technology you can learn as a programmer that it's truly beautiful. But when it comes to roadmaps, there's never a one-size-fits-all solution. So if you're an absolute beginner, try going through my roadmap that I mentioned in this video and see how it goes. If you like this roadmap video, check out my front-end developer roadmap video and my back-end developer roadmap video if you like this type of content. What software roadmap would you like to see next? Make sure you like, comment, and subscribe for more developer content. Peace out, coders.